So let's look at a quadratic interpolant. So in a quadratic interpolant, and we'll just look at a single element this time. To have a quadratic interpolation, you have to have a node that's central to the element itself. Okay? So you have a node that's central to the element itself. And you know, this is x. So we'll use node 1, 2, 3. Right, so this is still element. This is still element 2. So we have a local node numbering scheme 1, 2, 3. Okay, and for a quadratic interpolation, we want to have that u of h is equal to nj uj is equal to c1 plus c2 x. Plus c3 x cubed. All right. So if you remember, the first thing I did, here was I wrote these equations. So I evaluated, this guy at every node, and so I wrote those system of equations, and then I wrote them in matrix form. Okay. So this time, I'm just going to write down the matrix form directly, right? And in this case, our element is going to be of length L, such that the distance, node 2 is central to distance, central with respect to node 1 and 3, so that there's L over 2 on each side. And so if I write down those matrix equations exactly, directly, I have 1, 0, 0, 1, L over 2 squared, 1, L squared. C1, C2, C3. And again, in matrix form, this would be U, A, C. So everybody know where I got A, right? I just evaluated my approximate, my interpolant, C1 plus C2x plus C3x squared, at each of the nodes, right? So at node 1, x is 0, so I get 1, 0, 0, right? At node 2, it's l over 2, so I get 1, l over 2, l over 2 squared, right? Just plugging in the location of the x location of node 2 into that equation at the top, right? And I just construct this A matrix. So does everybody see that if I let a vector x transpose equal to 1x x squared, then I can write this equation as x transpose c? So I'm just going to move down here, and I'm going to say that this is n transpose u equal to x transpose c, right? That's just restating this equation, right? This is This is N transpose U, X transpose C. Right? But now I have an equation for U. U is AC. So if I plug that in, say that N transpose is A times C is equal to X transpose C. The C's will cancel, right? And then I can multiply what's left on the right-hand side by A inverse. Right, well, what's A times A inverse? It's the identity matrix. The identity matrix times the vector is the vector. So I get N transpose equal to X transpose A inverse. So this is a very simple systematic way to determine what the shape functions are for any order polynomial interpolate, because X is just the polynomial approximation, right? That you could, in 1D it's easy, but in 2D it would just come from Pascal's triangle or whatever we talked about, right? So it's just 1x, x squared, right? And then A, if you notice, A is just X evaluated at all the nodes, right? So you might write this as, so you have X transpose, and then you just have X transpose evaluated at X equals, I'll say X equals X1, you know, for the position of node 1, X equals X2, X equals X3, right? Inverse. And it, this is for the quadratic case, but it would work if I go higher order, right? So, so let's do the linear case, right? So we're going to assume a linear element that goes from 0 to L, right? A linear interpolated element that goes from 0 to L. So for a linear, my X is 1 and X, right? My A is X evaluated at the first node, which is 0, and X evaluated at the second node, which is L. Right, and you'll see that it's a matrix. Right. And so N is simply X times the inverse of A. And it'd be just, you know, in Mathematica, if I used a single brace, that's a row vector, it's a list. If I wanted to make it a column, I would then put a second one around it. But I'm not going to type two extra braces and then transpose it again when it's already a row vector. I'm not going to type extra code to then undo it. Right? So it's originally a row vector, I'll leave it a row vector. But if you did this in MATLAB, I think the default is a column vector, right? So you need to put the transpose. You need to transpose that if you're going to do this matrix operation. But you see, we get exactly what we derived by hand, right? And it works. We can go higher order too. So if I just copy everything, and then we just have to add an x squared term here. And so now, if it's quadratic, the second node is at L over 2. So we're going to evaluate this at L over 2. And then the third node is at L, is at X evaluated at L.
I said
that XA minus XB equals the L. So then in that case, it doesn't matter. I mean, you could put in all the values if you want. I mean, this is going to be the shape. This is the shape function for an element that goes from 0 to L. And yeah, I mean, I guess there is a little bit of subtlety in that. It would only matter if you have coefficients that are functions of x in your, I mean, we haven't introduced any physics or any problem yet, right? We're just talking about interpolation. But if we sort of look ahead, if you know, we had this generic differential equation that's like, a of x partial squared u partial x plus f of x plus c of x b u. It equals f of x. So we had that sort of generic difference equation. In this case, if these are truly functions of a, I mean, truly functions of x, then yeah, you'll need to construct the shape functions using the right values of the nodes. Right? If you had however, you had a uniform discretization where every element was just 0 to L, 0 to L, 0 to L, and your coefficients here were not functions of x, then you could just use the shape function, same shape functions everywhere.
So x here is
local, right? In this sort of example, yeah, x would be local. Right? But if you have this case, then you need to use the global x, and you have to construct your shape functions correctly as you go along. Now, it turns out, later we're going to learn some tricks that, namely with respect to doing integration over parent elements and other things that sort of I don't want to jump ahead, but as of what you know today, yes, you would have to construct the shape functions over every element using the coordinates, the global coordinates of that element. Okay? Until I teach you something else. That's what you have to do. I'm going to set L equal to 1, just so I can, then we can plot these guys over 0 to 1. So those are the three shape functions for the quadratic element. And you'll notice a couple of things about them. And I'm just going to show it pictorially first, and then we'll look at them, sort of write it down in terms of math. But the first thing is, at any place along x, the shape functions will add to 1. It's real easy at the nodes, right? At the nodes, these two are 0 and that one's 1. At this node, these two are 0 and that one's 1. But also anywhere else. I mean, let's see. This is maybe about 0.6 or so. And so you have 0.6 plus 0.6, which would be 1.2. But then you have a minus roughly 0.2. So they add to 1. So anywhere they add to 1. Okay. We'll give that a name in a second. Another thing is they interpolate the data, right? So we had nodes at these locations, right? And the shape functions interpolate them, meaning they pass through them. Right? they pass through the data. And this is not always the case. This is what we're doing here is called Lagrange interpolation. And in a Lagrange polynomial interpolation, you'll always have this property where they do interpolate the data. But that's not always the case. You can use, like if you were to use B splines, that wouldn't be the case. And, you know, as far as the, you know, if I just we go back up here and we look at what the shape functions are, if I just write, take the sum of these, total, one.